So this is a little bit of Gershwin's American in Paris.
Fifth season with the Seattle Symphony Orchestra, and my first season being directly part of our union, the Seattle Symphony and Opera Players Organization, of which I am the current chairperson. So being a trumpet player, that's first and foremost what I do here. Everything else is secondary to that, albeit very important business as well. So every week I come in here and I usually play anywhere between 2 and 4 concerts, can be more, can be less here on the trumpet, and then behind the scenes with the union, we're working with our management and with our board to make sure things keep flowing and continue to bring great art to the Seattle community.
That's fantastic. Fantastic. Now, here's what I know to be true is Xander grabbed his trumpet for me, and I said, oh my gosh, would you play for us? So I want you to play here in a moment. But here's what's fascinating is his case had 4 trumpets. Is that right?
That's right.
4 or 5. 4 trumpets. And tell us why.
Professional trumpet players are usually guilty of having quite a few more instruments than they need, which, you know, guilty as charged, that's right. But in terms of what I actually would need in the workplace to properly do my job here, I would say that is really actually around 8 trumpets. I have a collection of 16 in total. Again, there's some redundancy in there, maybe some things that I could afford to sell off or something like that. But there's also emotional attachment to some of these instruments, so I don't really want to let them go. The trumpet I have in my hands right now is sort of the bread and butter of what I do in the symphony. This is what's most often being played. This is what we call a C trumpet. I also use a B flat trumpet, which has kind of a longer pipe here and is a lower instrument. A piccolo trumpet, which is about half the size, looks like the B flat and the C trumpet had a baby. And then a rotary trumpet, which has an entirely different valve system, and that's for German repertoire. We play the German repertoire of a certain time period. We're using these different style rotary instruments, produce a sound, I think, that's much more of a blend as opposed to this, which may be a little bit more focused.
Excellent, excellent. Now, did you always have natural talents and abilities as a trumpet player, or is this something you had to work at? Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yes and no. It's interesting you ask that. I would say that the earliest experience I had with the trumpet, if someone had watched me pick up the mouthpiece and just try to play for the first time, they would say, that guy has natural ability, as is exactly what happened. We wrote down on a sheet of paper what instruments we would like to try to play in the fifth grade. This is out in Virginia at the time. And I wrote down clarinet, trumpet, and then percussion. So as it came around, the trumpet mouthpiece was going around the room where the teacher would put some alcohol spray on it, wash it off, and, okay, try this. And for the kids that sort of couldn't make the mouthpiece vibrate at all, so this thing is right here, they say, maybe the trumpet isn't for you. So they handed it to me, and I just went, the first time I made a sound. Mm-hmm. And the teacher, you can see his head jerking, he was like, trumpet, done. So I guess I did have a natural ability to buzz my lips well into a mouthpiece in the fifth grade. And from there, it was sort of like I coasted. I just played the trumpet, I enjoyed playing it in, you know, elementary school band for a couple years, and then getting into middle school band. And I started private lessons at the end of seventh grade, and that's when things started to move forward quite a bit with my early teacher, Ben Pasquale, and then my high school teacher, Jim Bittner, really continued to push me. And I would say that at that point, my success on the trumpet sort of defined my career, because I was doing really well with things. I was getting first chair in the band, and then first chair in the all-state band, and the first chair in the all-state orchestra. All these things kind of started happening in quick succession, and then winning competitions that my teacher, my private teacher, was encouraging me to do. And so my family, there's no musicians in my family, so every parent is kind of looking out for their child thinking, oh gosh, you know, he's going into music, this trumpet thing, can he make money doing it? Is he gonna get a job?
Right.
And I think that once I started having a lot of success, and my private teacher behind the scenes having some conversations with my parents, trying to encourage them, be like, no, trust this, he's going to do well with this. And then I ended up getting into Juilliard, which was a total shock to both myself and my family, since past, you know, knowing that I was doing well in the Northern Virginia area of trumpet players,
sure,
how I fit into the United States, or let alone the world. Juilliard's a little over 40% international in a given year. I had no idea, and it was sort of like, oh wow, we're actually doing this. And so from there, I was kind of on reps. I'm a trumpet player, I'm going to trumpet player school, in effect. You know, Juilliard was mostly focused on the music part of things and a little bit of liberal art classes, but really it's just doing this. And I put all my eggs in that basket, and luckily I'm sitting here after winning an audition for the Seattle Symphony.
That is fantastic. Wow, what a story.
That's something else.
What,
yeah,
a story, I mean, shoot. So let me ask you this. It sounds pretty good. Like, okay, this was, clearly you had to work at it.
Oh yeah.
But it sounds like natural talent, things were coming easy to you. What obstacles did you come across, if any, in your journey?
We look
at people like you, or, you know, celebrities or athletes, and we just think, wow, they've always had it. But what
right.
we don't often do is pause to consider the obstacles or the challenges. So I'm curious about that and what you did to overcome those.
Yeah, I mean, there were some tough times in terms of physically playing the trumpet for me, the most recent of which was when I sort of had the dentist didn't expect things to go this way, but my wisdom teeth became impacted over time and really worsened. So that made it so here and there, I would more or less on a random basis not be able to play the trumpet because my mouth would swell up because of my wisdom teeth. So there was a time period which was terrifying that I have to have a oral surgeon go into my mouth and remove all these teeth, and then my teeth would fall into a different place. And the problem with that is that's going to change your embouchure, meaning how you put the trumpet on your face and how your jawline aligns. I was terrified of this, and I didn't know how it was going to resolve. So basically, I had the surgery because it was causing me one too many random issues in my job performance. And I couldn't play the trumpet for about a month, which is also terrifying.
At what point in your career was this? Was this when you were still in school?
No, this is when I was full professional. This was in 2014, actually.
Okay.
This is when this all went down. This is a very scary time. That it's like sort of in the beginning of my professional career.
Sure.
I had this issue to resolve. And as it turns out, after taking a month off, which I had literally never done before, maybe I would take a week off on the high end of the amount of days I spend off Second Athlete, you know, just not doing for a week and expect to be able to perform the same way when you come back. So then coming back very, very, very slowly after that, and luckily I was able to rebuild my plane in about another month after that and get back to what I would say is a better level than where I was before, because I didn't have all that extra pain, especially random swelling associated with it.
Sure.
And I was fortunate that it went that way and didn't just become like a complete disaster where I was half the player I used to be because of this surgery. It all worked out just fine, and I'm very fortunate for that.
Right, absolutely. So I wonder, mindset is so important, right? It's your mentality, it's your attitude, is what you choose to do with the situation that's at hand. So tell me, what sorts of things were you telling yourself to help you stay the course?
Yeah, so it's one of those things where knowing my ability to play the trumpet previously, before I went into this, was the thing I kept in mind. So, you know, you're looking at something, it's really frustrating when you know you can play an instrument at a certain level, when you come back to it, and you're just nothing close to what you used to be. It's really fundamentally frustrating. I mean, imagine just anything that happens in life that you thought was a given, and then now overnight, it's not a given anymore. Anything along those lines is going to be fundamentally frustrating. But with the problem that I had specifically for me, I just kept faith that I was going to be able to get back to where I was if I was patient with it and just slowly willed away and getting back to where I was. And that did work out. Now, it wasn't easy at the time. It was difficult to keep that idea ahead of me that I knew that I was going to get back. It was really difficult to hold on to that at times. But luckily, I was already there at some point in my life, so it made it a little bit easier to aspire to that. As opposed to, you know, when I was developing as a trumpet player, I would listen to other players. Other people were my ideal. And at this time, I luckily had my own ideal to aspire to, which was, I would say, an easier process than just getting to where I was in the first place before having to deal with those teams.
Sure. Sure. You know, I talk a lot about this, and what I'm hearing sort of in a different framework is you had a vision for how you were going to recover.
Exactly.
So you kept he kept his eye on the prize, basically.
Yes.
And
put it that way very simply, yes.
Yeah, and even though it was difficult, it sounds like what you also did is you reached back to previous successes.
Yes.
And you drew on that. Okay, I am a successful professional trumpet player. I do have the skill, I do have the talent, I do have what it takes. I just need to exercise patience, as you said, and one step at a time.
Yes.
Get back into that.
That's right.
Wow. See? What can we learn? We all, here's the thing, is we all go through challenges, right?
Absolutely.
And really it's a lot about the mindset, which will tell us and dictate, you know, our destiny in those challenges. So it's good because, again, we can look at you and think, oh, glamorous, and here you are, but you're just like the rest of us.
Absolutely.
I love it. I am curious to know, what is your why? What is your why for wanting to be a professional trumpet player in the Seattle Symphony, as a matter of fact?
Yeah, I love this question. I love big orchestral music, pure and simple. That's what I love to listen to the most. That's what I love to experience in a concert the most, and I love to be a part of that ensemble. I think the trumpet plays, not always, but oftentimes a very glorious role in how the orchestra sounds. So I really love to be a part of that sound concept.
Mm-hmm. So in how many concerts did you say you would play in a week?
It varies, but I would say on average we're dealing with 2 to 4 concerts a week. But it can be a little bit higher than that, a little bit lower, but basically that's every week in general.
And each concert is different.
Each week is different. And inside of a week, there may be a couple of different concerts, but you look at it as, not including the opera, the symphony is one program per week or more. But that program will be done after that week. For instance, you saw the YEA concert, Youth Equity and Access concert with Macklemore and Ryan Lewis and Sierra and Russell Wilson. That was one of a couple other programs that were happening in the context of that week. This week, we're just doing one program. On our side, it's called Subscription 20. On your side, it's called Sibelius Kullervo with our inbound music director, Thomas Tausgaard. And so that will be happening 3 shows this week. And that is more or less normal business in the symphony.
Wow.
So the actual schedule for the orchestra, again, will vary a little bit from week to week depending on what we're playing. But we'll have rehearsals. Let's use this week as an example. Tuesday you have two rehearsals. One will be 2.5 hours with a 15-minute break. By the way, the 20-minute break, and one will be 2 hours with a 15-minute break. And then the following day, there was just a 2.5-hour rehearsal with a 20-minute break in it. And then this morning, there was a 2.5-hour rehearsal. And tonight will be the first concert. So you're looking at 4 rehearsals and 3 concerts this week. And for a subscription series, that's about right. That's about how many rehearsals there are. For different concerts, for maybe for a Pops concert, especially when it's a lot of familiar music that we've done before many times, it doesn't demand as much rehearsal time. So maybe there'll be 2 rehearsals, maybe 1 rehearsal for a Pops series. Or for the YEA concert, we had 2 rehearsals for that. And that would be normal business. 2 rehearsals for that one very special concert was enough time for us to prepare properly and sound at our best for that show. But some things that are unfamiliar, like the work happening this week, you're doing four full rehearsals.
Say that 10 times fast.
I'll try that one again. And it's with the chorus. So you also, instead of having rehearsals during the daytime, you're having some rehearsals starting at 7 p.m. so that our chorale, coming in from various jobs around the city, they can make it to rehearsal in time without missing any of their jobs.
I see.
It's a lot of details that have to kind of come together. And what's not included in any of these times is my own personal practice time, which the hours of that will probably be about the same as the hours I spend actually at the workplace. Learning the music and keeping up my own playing ability will be, on an average week, the same as or higher than the amount of hours I actually spend in the workplace.
Wow. So that's, is this full-time? Is this your full-time profession?
Okay. Absolutely.
I was just talking to a friend of mine whose son plays the French horn at Johns Hopkins. He actually had the opportunity to go to Juilliard, but he was saying, you know, ask them if this is Alexander's full-time gig, because it sounds like there's just such a time investment and practice investment that goes into that.
Absolutely. If you're just looking at the hours I spend here playing concerts or rehearsals, it looks like I just don't work that much. Mm-hmm. You look at the hours that are relatively low compared to the hours people are typically working in 9-to-5 jobs. Mm-hmm. What's not included is how much time goes in on my own personal time that I need to do that on my instrument, practice my own instrument before I come into work. So I don't just come into work and say, oh, what am I playing this week? No, I mean, weeks ahead of time, I've been learning that music and preparing whatever I need to for that week. So I'm always preparing something else in the middle of a given concert cycle. Because, like I said, each week is a different program, or possibly a couple different programs. So I'm having to maintain a lot of different things at the same time, which demands a lot of practice outside of the workplace. And that's the same for all of us.
Right. And so are all of the musicians full-time?
Yes.
Okay. Excellent. There's your answer.
Yeah, the people who listen to the Seattle Symphony's roster are all full-time musicians for the Seattle Symphony, most of which also work for the Seattle Opera.
Okay. Good to know. So tell us, what do you enjoy doing when you're not practicing or performing? What do you love? Tell us about that.
Well, recently the thing that's been really fun outside of work is doing a lot of sous vide cooking and a lot of sous vide barbecue, with the idea being without using a smoker or a barbecue grill, you're coming up with something that everyone thinks that you put it in a smoker for 12 hours. So recently, like sous vide brisket, actually the recipe by our friends in the Pike Place Market, Chef Steps, and their sous vide device called Joule, I use these to create their smokerless smoked brisket. And again, my friends that have smokers, I give them a taste of this and you can see their jaw drop, like, how did you do that? And I love to see that effect.
I can tell.
I love it.
That brings you great joy.
Oh, it really does. So I did a Memorial Day barbecue, and we did sous vide brisket, sous vide ribs, and sous vide sausages, which I then deep fried a little bit later.
Oh, wow.
So a whole bunch of these things, which people are wondering, how did you do it? In the water bath. So.
Well, how can I get on that invite list?
We'll talk about that later.
For that.
There's a bit of a waiting list for that.
I bet. That's fantastic. Tell me what's next for you as you're writing the next chapter for you? I know you're still heavily involved here, but what do you see as next chapter for you, or what are you keeping your eye on?
Well, honestly, the next chapter for me has everything to do with exactly the work I'm doing here, playing the trumpet here. Of course, I'm always aspiring to be the best version of myself as a trumpet player, but also to have the best possible relationship between our union, which is all of our musicians, with our management and with our board. Because if you have a harmonious relationship of all three parties, which is hard to achieve and should be recognized as something very, very precious that we have in our organization at the moment, that we'll be able to continue to expand the scope of the symphony, including our major education efforts, you know, as the Youth Equity and Access Concert, which raises a ton of money to expand our efforts in education throughout the city, musical education. This is a major priority for us, and we're all on board with trying to expand that and make it happen in the best possible way. So I think that the next chapter for me involves all of this, trying to keep that relationship of the union with the employer, with the management of the symphony, and with our wonderful board, to keep those powers aligned so that we can really move forward with our business with the Seattle Symphony Orchestra.
Absolutely, and that education piece in the community is huge, and I would like to say, I mean, what an amazing event with Macklemore, Sierra, Russell Wilson, and the symphony. I took, you know, great delight in seeing the students from Garfield up on stage, and Macklemore's students performing, and it's just holistically, again, giving access to the youth in the area and showing them what they can do and supporting them and encouraging them. And in that night, and they brought the house down is what I say, but in that night, over $1 million were raised.
Yeah, I think 1.4, that number continues to track upward.
Yep, so that's great. You know, I know a lot of people are interested in the symphony. What would you tell us, anyone who's listening, how they can get involved or what we might want to know about the symphony that might help us step into symphony life here in Seattle a little bit more?
Well, that's an excellent question. I mean, I think that a good way to start is to take a look at our schedule, seattlesymphony.org, and see if there's something in that schedule that really catches your eye. Because we put on a huge, diverse amount of concerts throughout the year, and there's probably something there for everyone. And past that, there's probably something there that you didn't even realize was something that was for you. I mean, I always kind of think of the symphony as like getting into something like wine or cooking, that you had no idea what all was there until you decided to get into it. And so I encourage everyone to take a taste, you know, come see something that is something you think that you will like. And then I, of course, love to connect with people on a personal basis and ask them what they liked about something. And then I can recommend them a concert that they wouldn't have expected would be something that they would love.
Right.
Because I know all this music, at least most of the stuff we do, I have done before at some point. And I can say, hey, Cam, well, based on you liking this, you would definitely need to come to this concert at this time. And that's what also our ticket office is here to help people make some decisions as to when they might want to show up.
Excellent. Excellent. And I'll end with this before I ask you to play, so think about what you want to you want to play for us. But last season I was able to attend with Susan and our friends the John Williams concert.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so you know John Williams, the composer for Star Wars and beyond.
Yep.
And it was amazing. It was
phenomenal concert.
Phenomenal education, and it was amazing. So there really is something for everybody. So
yes, and Steven Spielberg came and showed up to MC the last part of that concert.
That's right.
Unannounced ahead of time.
Did
you talk about bringing
the
house down. I knew a little bit in advance.
Okay.
But that was something really spectacular. So that was a huge thanks to John Williams and Steven Spielberg for coming in and doing that with us. That was one of the special concerts of my career.
Oh, fantastic. And I got to be here.
That's right. Good time.
Fabulous. Okay, well, here's what I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in because I'd love to really get you in full action. And
sure.
You play just as long as you want for us. I'm sure it will be a delight for all of us to hear.
So for trumpet auditions, there's a kind of a list of things that we have to go through. So I'll play a few of those things that tend to show up on trumpet auditions. This is the promenade from Mussorgsky's Pictures at an Exhibition.
Mm-hmm. let's see, what's a couple of more? We'll do Beethoven's Leonore. Wow, that's a good one. You know, I think that something that's really integral to trumpet playing and developing trumpet playing, but that applies to everything in general, is having a concept or an image of the character you want to be or the sound you would like to create, and then everything you do is going in that direction. Because without a clear concept of character, without a clear concept of music in your mind, you have no direction. So I think that defining one's direction, of course, now this direction will change over time, but always having that character or sound or style, whatever you may be doing, always having that well defined for yourself, I think, is the single most important thing in life.
That's profound. I'll take that with me.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kim.